Hi, I'm Marc Lynch, the director of the Institute for Middle East Studies at George Washington University and the project on Middle East political science. Welcome back to the POMEPS conversation series with leading scholars in the field. With me today is Jillian Schwedler, professor of political science at the University of Massachusetts Amherst and moving next fall to Hunter College in New York. Jillian is the author of Faith in Moderation, a great book on Muslim Brotherhood in Jordan and Yemen, and she's been working for the last few years on a book on protest in Jordan, which is a good time. The timing is good for us to talk about protest in Jordan. So we've got people out in the streets angry about fuel prices. What do you make of what's happening in Jordan right now?
Well, one of the things that's interesting about thinking about what's happening in Jordan right now is to acknowledge there's been a long history of protest activity in Jordan. And so what we're seeing now really is in many ways a rupture of the activities we've seen over the past decades. My book was conceptualized, the book I'm working on now was conceptualized before the Arab Spring started, about the fact you have a lot of routine protest in a country like Jordan that's part of politics as usual. Certain actors are in certain places and they routinely come out. And so in making sense of what's happening now...
What's a normal protest? Describe to us like a normal protest.
A normal protest, for example, would be the Muslim Brotherhood gets out 400 to 600 people in downtown Amman after Friday prayer. They hang out for a few hours. They march to one of the municipal buildings, and then they disperse after a few hours. It's pretty routine. Everybody knows the script. It really follows a really traditional, familiar path. And those have been going on for decades. And there's different places around the country where there's protests in familiar ways and familiar places. And so what's happening now, it's not that the scale is so massive, although the last few days actually have been pretty significant. But over the past year, while Jordan is often said wrongly to have not been touched by the Arab uprisings, in fact it has, we've seen these little ruptures and people doing things different than they had done before. So, for example, directly criticizing the king is something new that's off. You're not allowed to do it by law. You can spend up to 3 years in jail for criticizing the king directly. And we've had over the past year some incidences of burning his photograph, directly critiquing him. In the past, what was normal was you critique the prime minister. You focused right. All your attention on the cabinet. Everyone knew the regime was pulling the strings, but it was kind of understood that that was the boundary. And now what you're seeing is people are calling, you know, directly critiquing the regime. In the past few days, we actually heard the people want the fall of the regime chant, which had been missing in Jordan. Mm-hmm. Now, I think what's interesting about the protests we're seeing is, for the most part, the people that are on the street now are on the street for economic grievances, which shouldn't be surprising because every time we have price hikes, right, we have people on the street in Jordan, so I don't know why anyone's surprised by this. But it's not the youth movements, it's not the Hirak, this sort of collection of youth activists, it's not the political parties, although they're out there. It's a different crowd that have been organizing these protests over the past year throughout the country. You're actually seeing a flood, a more sort of popular flood of people on the street in these past few days.
Like what kinds of people? If it's not the youth coalition and it's not the political parties, who are these new protesters?
Well, obviously I'm watching from afar, but from what I understand and from what I can tell, there are people from neighborhoods frustrated about the cost of, you know, home cooking gas. You do, of course, in Mon, places where the petrol is important to the trucking industry, see those familiar people moving out on the streets. And there are protests, from what I understand, in every single part of the country, in every province, all parts of the city. So this is a national movement in these past few days. But you also seem to be seeing people, so a lot of the groups that had been organizing protesters are saying, you know, these aren't the crowds that we have been calling out. We're, you know, they're on the streets. And in some cases, some of the youth groups have been calling for peaceful protest, not the rioting and looting and burning of buildings and cars that we're seeing happening now. They've been saying, let's not do this. This isn't us. It's a peaceful protest. Let's back off. Let's hold off a day. And yesterday, on Wednesday, they had called for a pulling back and that Friday there would be a major protest, but a peaceful protest. Everyone's getting in on the action. Of course, the usual actors are out there now, but it's not only the usual actors the way it had been, as far as I can tell, the way it had been for the past year, the sort of new groups and political parties and professional associations. You seem to also have just a mass of people very frustrated with the government.
How is this different from, say, 1996? Where you have, you know, the protests in the South against fuel price and subsidies. What's different now?
Well, the scale seems to be different for one thing, and the direct critiques of the regime, calling for the king to be accountable, some of the chants, king, get out of our lives, calling for peace and justice, and of course the context of the Arab uprisings.
Why do you think it is? Why this new focus on the king? If this was taboo in the past, why are people now willing or even eager to break that taboo?
That's a great question. I think in some ways that the Arab uprisings have raised a specter of a different kind of politics to be imagined. And you know, concern about what the regime's policies are, the economic reforms, et cetera. There's a lot of grievances in the country. They're not coalescing into united movement because some of the groups want more regime. You know, they want more subsidies, more jobs. They don't want a scaling back. They don't want a different regime. They want more of the old regime. Mm-hmm. And other groups want democracy. Other groups simply want economic reforms. And this is, you know, normal when you have these kind of mass movements, people having very different grievances.
Right.
But I think because of the uprisings, there's, you know, this sort of even people want the fall of the regime is a slogan directly lifted from other countries. And so I think it's you know, very nervous-making for the regime that though that language is finding its way into protests now. But it didn't just happen in these past few days. It's happened over the past, you know, year and a half, 2 years, this, you know, cautious testing of pushing the boundaries of the familiar protest script that had been in place since, you know, 89.
Right. But so where is the Muslim Brotherhood in all of this? They've traditionally been the largest and best organized political movement, and yet there's a sense that they're not the driving force in this new round of protest. So where are they in response to this new social mobilization?
Well, I think they're not the driving force. They are out there, and they've been very vocal. I think they want to, maybe perhaps, you don't want to draw too many parallels, but as in Egypt, they want to sort of then own the mobilization, and they have been, you know, having several, you know, massive mobilizations, and they have been active on the streets. But I think they want to—they're trying to own this right now. In some ways, they're calling for a reduction of violence. They don't want the looting, but they're calling for a delay in the parliamentary elections, which they've vowed to have boycotted. So they want a delay in the elections. They're calling again for a new electoral law. So I think they're trying to insert themselves as this, as they are and as they've done, insert themselves as a major actor on the political scene that the regime has to deal with them.
If they wanted to damp things down, could they?
They meaning the Muslim Brotherhood?
The Muslim Brotherhood or Al-Hira, the youth coalition. Is there any kind of central leadership that would be able to have a strategic approach to these protests? Or is it just spontaneous demonstrations in lots of different parts of the country outside of anyone's control?
I think it's the latter. I think there's spontaneous demonstrations outside of anyone's control. But I do think if the Muslim Brotherhood were to entirely withdraw from the streets and the other groups to withdraw from the streets, you would leave this unaligned group there that you know, the gendarmerie, the Darak riot police are willing to bash heads and they, you know, mm-hmm. fire live ammunition. If the major political groups and the professional associations were all to withdraw, their call for withdrawal from people from the street, I think you would see a very thin crowd remained that the regime could then go and repress pretty seriously.
Now, you mentioned the Darak. I mean, one of the things which is interesting in Jordan as opposed to, say, Egypt is counter-mobilization on the side of the regime. Do you see that as kind of authentic counter-mobilization or just something which the security forces are using as a way to beat back the protesters?
I think it's probably actually both. I think there are, you know, authentic counter-protests. In some senses, as I said, some of the protests that have taken place over the past year have been, you know, wanting more regime. You're breaking our bond, you know, the sort of tribal groups that are, they're frustrated with the regime because they understand that we've been playing this game over the years, that we'll support you, but you have to give us goodies in return. And as those goodies have been, you know, withdrawn, they feel it's a broken bargain. So they're, you know, protesting, but they're also calling for more. But I think they also come out against the groups that are calling for democratization and the overthrow of the regime. They don't want the overthrow of the regime. They want more of the old regime. And so I think some of those are spontaneous. But by all counts, but I mean, I hear many, many things from protesters that they're confident, that they recognize, you know, police and security will round up people and bring them in government vehicles to a site, and they'll pour out of these buses as the loyalist marches. And so I think there's clearly evidence that a lot of these are organized.
Yeah.
How high up in the government, you know, we of course don't know, but someone in official capacity is bringing in some crowds. But I do think it'd be a mistake to suggest that they're all orchestrated by the regime. I do think there is significant dissent around the regime sort of withdrawing services, provisions, jobs, et cetera.
Right. What about the elections that are scheduled for January that the opposition is planning to boycott? How important or how significant is the formal political institutional realm for what's going on right now? Could better elections resolve these social issues, or is it just completely disconnected from what people actually care about?
Well, I don't think it could withdraw the social issues writ large, but I think it could make a significant difference. Not because the electoral law, of course, isn't that big of a change. It isn't as much a change as many people wanted for. The Muslim Brotherhood and the political parties are very frustrated because it continues to be a mechanism to limit their influence. It continues to be a mechanism to reduce the voice, the appropriate voice of Palestinian people, who by all counts are a majority of the citizens of the country. At the same time, I think what's important about those elections upcoming is that the king has said on several occasions recently that in this round, the prime minister is going to be selected by that assembled body. And that could be a significant change. And so I think the stakes of the election aren't about whether that assembly is going to really produce governance in a meaningful way, but whether that extra step of allowing that shift to take place, which would be a significant move, whether that takes place or not. I mean, I think that's what's at stake. I see it disconnected, though, in many ways from the protests on the street. In some ways, it'll be, again, a bait and switch, a sort of, you know, look over here, look at the birdie over here at the elections, and let's not protest on the street. Let's all come together as a nation and focus on this change. And anyone who continues to protest about other issues then becomes unpatriotic.
One last thing. You've written some really interesting things in the past on the changes in kind of urban geography and kind of the reshaping of the city of Amman to basically marginalize protest and make it very difficult for protesters to gain access to broader publics. So now they can go and protest downtown Amman, but nobody goes there anymore, like that sort of thing. And it seems like the locus point for most of the most contentious protests has been Diwan al-Dakhliya, the Interior Ministry. What do you make of that location, and why is that available to protesters, or is it?
It's a great question. I think it's actually not available to protesters, and I think it's you know, historically, and this is where it's important to look at the history of protests, it hasn't been a site of protest. The sites of protest have been either downtown or parliament or the prime ministry, these sort of sites of governance, but not the Ministry of the Interior. The circle itself isn't a great place to protest. It has overpass, and so it's, you know, it's overpass, and then there's this traffic-y circle. It's not really the best venue. I think it became really explosive because there's an example of the Arab uprisings having an effect. In Tunisia, where you were not, you literally were not allowed to look at the Ministry of the Interior, in the days before Ben Ali's departure, the people are crowded in front of the Ministry in the Interior, screaming "Degage!" You know, go at the Ministry. And so the Ministry is seen as the central repressive, you know, the site of the central repressive mechanisms in the country, the secret police, etc. It's sort of that site of internal repression. Likewise, in Egypt, we want to try to get to these symbolic places. And I think looking at that kind of geography, the sort of that place in Jordan is incredibly explosive and incredibly nervous-making for the regime. As you know, in 2011, in March, there were protests all over Jordan, but a few hundred people tried to establish an ongoing sit-in at the Interior Ministry, at that circle, and that was repressed very quickly, within a day, and very harshly, while other protests of, you know, tens of thousands sometimes are left alone because they follow a typical course and they disperse after a few hours. And so I think, again, in the past couple days, we've seen like thousands of people go to that. I think it's very symbolically important. It's a terrible venue for protest, but it's symbolically very in your face to the regime. And I think that change is significant to it.
Why Interior Ministry and not the palace?
That's a great question. Yeah,
and is that going too far?
Perhaps. I think that the Diwar Dakhli, the Interior Ministry Circle, is very accessible.
Yes.
It's immediately accessible. It shuts down traffic, except for the overpass, but you can also shut down that traffic. I think it's a bit more accessible. It's in very middle class and lower middle class neighborhoods at quite close proximity. So I think it's an easy rallying point. But unlike Egypt, there isn't that central Tahrir obvious square. And so in some ways, the way that's worked in Jordan is they are dispersed. They're in different locations. But now they're so dispersed, there's so many, that the fact that they're dispersed makes it seem flooded, that the country's flooded with demonstrations. It seems that no neighborhood, from what I'm seeing, is untouched by some kind of presence on the street.
So we've been recording this on the second day of major protests in Jordan. We'll see how they play out. Jillian Schwedler from University of Massachusetts Amherst and moving soon to Hunter College. Thanks for coming.
Thank you very much.